His Honor, Administrator.
Please be seated. Madam Speaker, and members of the Manitoba Legislature, I welcome you to the first session of the 42nd Legislative Assembly of the Province of Manitoba. Je vous souhaite la bienvenue à la première session de la 42e Legislature de la province du Manitoba. I offer my congratulations to all new and returning members of this assembly. I also offer the congratulations and appreciation of all Manitobans to all candidates who sought election to this assembly in the recent election. Your commitment and contribution to the validity of our democracy is deserving of our respect. To all Manitobans, your government is grateful for the honor to continue serving the people of our province. You have renewed your government's mandate to continue its mission of fixing Manitoba's finances, repairing its services, and rebuilding its economy. While significant progress was made in all three areas during the previous term, much work remains to be done in order to complete the task of moving Manitoba forward towards greater prosperity for all. As a government that keeps its promises, your government will continue to work to make Manitoba more economically competitive by reducing regulatory red tape and encouraging innovation. Passage of the Business Registration, Supervision, and Ownership Transparency Act, various acts amended, will help Manitoba complete implementation of the New West Partnership Trade Agreement and will provide Manitobans with more access to customers and opportunities across Western Canada. Your government will address the issues of addictions and honor its obligation to keep our streets safe from crime. And your government will continue to work to strengthen our education system, support families in need, and deliver better health care sooner for all Manitobans. In the coming days, this assembly will be asked to complete all necessary legislative requirements in order to fully implement the measures outlined in Budget 2019, measures that increase funding for healthcare, education, and families, measures that increase support for tourism and our creative industries, while also investing more than $1 billion in strategic infrastructure, and most importantly, measures that lower the provincial sales tax to 7%. In 2011, the previous government was elected based on its promise to not raise the provincial sales tax and a commitment to let Manitobans vote on major tax hikes. Just 18 months later, both of those promises were broken. After making more goods and services subject to the PST, The PST rate was increased to 8% without the consent of Manitobans. That increase took more than $300 million annually off the kitchen tables of Manitobans. The previous government took more from Manitobans and gave less. Your government is committed to taking less from Manitobans and giving them more. Reducing the PST back to 7% is part of your government's plan to guarantee $2,020 in tax savings for Manitobans over the next years. Manitobans have given your government the mandate to move forward towards a stronger economy, better services, and better jobs. The work to achieve those goals resumes today. They will continue to guide the decisions of this government throughout its mandate. It is the path Manitobans have chosen, it is the bright future they deserve, and it is what your government will work hard to deliver. I now leave you to the business of the session, knowing you will faithfully discharge your duties and responsibilities. May divine providence continue to bless our province and guide this assembly in all of its deliberations. God bless Manitoba. God bless Canada. God save the Queen.
O eternal and almighty God, from whom all power and wisdom come, we are assembled here before thee to frame such laws as may tend to the welfare and prosperity of our province. Grant, O merciful God, we pray thee, that we may desire only that which is in accordance with thy will, that we may seek it with wisdom, know it with certainty, and accomplish it perfectly, for the glory and honor of thy name, and for the welfare of all our people. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, I would just like to take a moment to welcome everybody back, and especially to all the new members who are joining us here. A very special occasion it is for you, I'm sure, and all the best to everybody as you are taking on your new tasks before you. The Honourable First Minister.
I move, seconded by the member for Borderlands, that Bill number 1, an act respecting the administration of oaths of office, loi sur la prestation des serments d'entrée en fonction, be now read a first time.
It has been moved by the Honourable First Minister, seconded by the Honourable Member for Borderland, that Bill number 1, an act respecting the administration of oaths of office, be now read a first time. Is it the pleasure of the House to adopt the motion? Agreed? Agreed and so ordered. The Honourable First Minister.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I move, seconded by the Member for Southdale, that my motion has the name of the member, Madam Speaker. I need your guidance. It's appropriate to say the name. Doyle Pinyuk, member for the Electoral Division of Turtle Mountain, be chairperson of the committees of the whole House and deputy speaker.
It has been moved by the Honourable First Minister, seconded by the Honourable Member for Southdale, that Doyle Pinyuk, member for the Electoral Division of Turtle Mountain, be chairperson of the committees of the whole House and Deputy Speaker. Is it the pleasure of the House to adopt the motion? Agreed? Agreed and so ordered. The Honourable First Minister.
Madam Speaker, I move, seconded by the member for Morden-Winkler, that Dennis Smook, member for the Electoral Division of Laveranderie, be deputy chairperson of the committees of the whole House.
It has been moved by the Honourable First Minister, seconded by the Honourable Member for Morden-Winkler, that Dennis Smook, member for the Electoral Division of Laveranderie, be the deputy chairperson of the committees of the whole House. Is it the pleasure of the House to adopt the motion? Agreed? Agreed and so ordered. The Honourable First Minister.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I move, seconded by the member for Tuxedo, that Andrew Micklefield, member for the Electoral Division of Rossmere, be deputy chairperson of the committees of the whole House.
It has been moved by the Honourable First Minister, seconded by the Honourable Member for Tuxedo, that Andrew Micklefield, Member for the Electoral Division of Rossmere, be Deputy Chairperson of the Committees of the Whole. Is it the pleasure of the House to adopt the motion? Agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed and so ordered. The Honourable First Minister.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I move, seconded by the Member for Spruce Woods, that the speech of His Honour, the Administrator, be taken into consideration today.
It has been moved by the Honourable First Minister, seconded by the Member for Spruce Woods, that the speech of His Honour, the Administrator, be taken into consideration today. Is it the pleasure of the House to adopt the motion? Agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed and so ordered. The Honourable Government House Leader.
On House Business, Madam Speaker, Could you please canvass the House for leave to limit the debate on the address and reply to the speech from the throne to three members in the following order: the leader of the official opposition, the member for St. Boniface, and the premier. Each member's speech would be limited to 5 minutes, and following the third speech, the speaker would be obligated to put the question on the motion.
Is there leave to limit the debate on the address in reply to the speech from the throne to three members in the following order: the leader of the official opposition, the member for St. Boniface, and the premier. Each member's speech would be limited to 5 minutes, and following the third speech, the speaker would be obligated to put the question on the motion. Is there leave? Leave has been granted. The Honourable Member for Dawson Trail.
I move, seconded by the member for Seine River, that the following address be presented to His Honour, the Administrator. We, the members of the Legislative Assembly of Manitoba, thank Your Honour for the gracious speech addressed to us at the first session of the 42nd Legislature of Manitoba.
It has been moved by the Honourable Member for Dawson Trail, seconded by the Honourable Member for Seine River, that the following address be presented to His Honour the Administrator. We, the members of the Legislative Assembly of Manitoba, thank Your Honour for the gracious speech addressed to us at this first session of the 42nd Legislature of Manitoba. The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition. Here.
Miigwech, Madam Speaker, and I want to say a big thank you, Gitchin Miigwech, to the people of Fort Rouge for sending me back to this chamber to serve in another legislature, and also a congratulations to all my colleagues returning and new MLAs. I am very proud to stand with a strengthened opposition team that will work very hard to keep this government to account. I want to take a minute to acknowledge that everyone on our team did something very difficult to be here. Some of them made history in their election to this chamber. Others defeated cabinet ministers or incumbent MLAs, and still others conducted themselves with great integrity, honesty, and perspicacity in finding their way to the hallowed chamber of the Manitoba Legislative Assembly. And we will certainly need all of those skills and attributes to be able to hold this government to account. We know that their focus in the last legislature was to cut health care, to close emergency rooms, and to raise the cost of people's Manitoba Hydro bill. And our increased size of our caucus on this side is a clear repudiation of this government's agenda, and we will hold them to account each and every day, Madam Speaker. It gives me great pleasure to stand here as the voice of progressive Manitoba. And we heard in that short throne speech that this government saw fit to bring forward an extended soliloquy made up of partisan attacks, and yet they didn't even mention climate change once, Madam Speaker. And this just a few days after my colleagues and I joined 12,000 people out front of this building as the young people of our province and our world demanded that we take immediate and substantial action to address the issue of our time, which is climate change. On a perhaps more cross-partisan note, Madam Speaker, today is Orange Shirt Day, and I want to thank all my returning colleagues who did support the Orange Shirt Day Act in the last legislature, which recognizes this day officially in our province as one that we observe in honor and commemoration of the survivors of Indian residential schools. Our country has learned the lessons of the past to a certain extent. We saw the apology on behalf of the Crown by Prime Minister Harper in 2008. And now it is up to each of us to carry the lessons of that past dark era forward and to ensure that no child in this country is separated by force from their family simply because of who they are. And perhaps more importantly, that we never see fit to allow a government policy to judge an entire group of people based on racist and outmoded thinking. And so the true import and significance of this Orange Shirt Day in 2019 is that it's another opportunity for us to stand together and reaffirm that slogan that we now see printed on t-shirts, that every child matters. In our language, and I'll table the Anishinaabe transition for the benefit of Hanser, we say, Gakina abononchiyak apitenda goziyak, every child matters. The significance of this, Madam Speaker, is that the residential school survivors themselves stood up, demanded justice of this country, and when they were met by leaders of the federal and provincial government, they displayed a great amount of wisdom, a great amount of compassion, and a great amount of courage, which I think is a true lesson on what it means to be a human being. That when you are done wrong, the proper response of a fully formed human being is not to strike back, but rather to rise above with love, with compassion, and with generosity. And so while we honor the residential school survivors themselves on Orange Shirt Day, we ought also to take a moment to recognize the true lessons of humanity that have been shown by these generations in many of our communities. In the past year, I wrote to the Prime Minister asking him to make Orange Shirt Day a federal statutory holiday. And it is my hope that this will be accomplished by the next Prime Minister of our country. I will write to the next Prime Minister to do so. It would be a fitting tribute to these residential school survivors. It would mark the progress that our nation has made while still giving us an opportunity to commemorate their courage, their grace, and their compassion. And so perhaps that's something that the Premier and I can work together on during this legislature. With that, I say thank you again to everybody who played a role in sending us here, and congrats once again to all the elected members.
The Honourable Member for St. Boniface.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I'd like to start by acknowledging Orange Shirt Day. It's a reminder of the casual daily cruelty and denial of dignity that it was a legacy of residential schools, as well as the ongoing decades-long legacy of governments undermining and tearing apart First Nations families. We must remind ourselves this day and every day that every child matters. We must reflect, too, that the residential schools mark the worst of what government can do. Institutional cruelty, neglect, and death, even as warnings were raised over a century ago that what was taking place was a national crime. Set against this, we are also today marking the outcome of an election which in many ways represents the very best of our values. Democracy offers us the peaceful transition of power. And while we live in a society that is unequal and is growing more unequal, the democratic right to vote means that at the ballot box, at least, every person is equal. We can and should lament that more Manitobans did not vote and that so many people feel disengaged from the political process. I am grateful to everyone who put their name forward to make democracy better in Manitoba. I say that especially for candidates who ran under the Manitoba Liberal banner, but it is true of all parties. There are good people in every party, and no one has a monopoly on good ideas, though sometimes it certainly seems this government has a monopoly on bad ones. Our job is not just to criticize, but to demand that government prove its case. Much of politics is treated as theater, which is to say, it is assumed by the people watching it that it is not serious, that people pretend to be someone they're not, and recite lines over and over that someone else wrote for them. One consequence of this is that the theater of lip service is seen as a substitute of action. The decisions made in this chamber every day have an impact on the lives of over 1 million people in Manitoba, and more besides when we include our role in Canada and the world. This is not just a question of decisions to act, but decisions not to act, that Manitobans may be harmed by neglect and cuts. And there are many areas where we are deeply, deeply concerned about this government's policies on healthcare, education, climate change, on the economy, and indeed on democracy, that these systems are already more fragile than the government realizes, and the measures this government is proposing is putting them at greater risk when we need to be strengthening them. In the often hyper-partisan atmosphere in this chamber, it is easy to dismiss complaints as theater or posturing. I hope we can consider the serious nature of the decisions we make, that we approach our task as legislators with humility, and when necessary, set aside our partisan blinders to listen in earnest to the voices of people who cry out for help or in warning that we are headed in the wrong direction. We have the opportunity in this chamber to set our province on a path that will affect people's lives for the better or for the worse for years and decades to come. Our obligation is to the future, not just ourselves. We look forward to working with you all. Thank you. Merci.
The Honourable First Minister.
Thank you very much. Congratulations on your re-election as Speaker, Madam Speaker. Also, congratulations to my colleague, the member for Fort Rouge, and to his team, including all those who sought office under the banner of the Democratic Party, as well to my colleague from St. Boniface. Congratulations also to him and to all of his candidates who sought office on behalf of the Liberal Party. And congratulations, of course, as well to all my colleagues here and all who sought office on behalf of the Progressive Conservative Party, and to all who put their name on the ballot. Thank you for making democracy work and for giving Manitobans a choice. It is my hope that this Assembly will continue to be the foundation for ongoing dialogue, for cooperation, for debate on important issues. I look forward to working with all my colleagues here to move our beloved Manitoba forward as we continue in our efforts to fix the finances, to repair the services, to rebuild the economy of our province. Madam Speaker, back in 2016, our PC team asked Manitobans for their trust. And in return, we said that we would keep our word, and we established a plan that included better jobs, better care, better education, better value for money, and better together. And promises were made, Madam Speaker, promises were kept. And Madam Speaker, 3 weeks ago, on September 10th, Manitobans renewed their confidence in this party and in its leadership, and they made their choice. And their choice was forward, not backward. They elected the largest back-to-back majority governments in the history of Manitoba. And we will move forward, Madam Speaker, forward to better care sooner, forward to better education, better outcomes for our children, and 20 new schools, forward to a Made in Manitoba climate and green plan, forward to a stronger economy and 40,000 new jobs, and forward to affordability, which means, Madam Speaker, lower taxes and more money on the kitchen tables of Manitoba families, Manitoba small businesses, and Manitoba seniors. Over the course of the next couple of months, our government will be putting forth an ambitious 100-day agenda that will see record tax relief, better health care sooner, more schools for students, more jobs for Manitobans, and Made in Manitoba climate change solutions. And we will bring forward legislation to begin implementation of the 2020 dollar tax rollback guarantee. We will work towards implementing recommendations from the 2019 review of planning, permitting, and zoning to help do a better job of attracting capital and creating jobs in this province. And we will host the inaugural Manitoba Jobs Summit later this week. Working with the Winnipeg Regional Health Authority, we will create 200 new nursing positions. We will continue with the planning and then the construction of the St. Boniface Emergency Department. And we will initiate the Frontline Ideas Fund for healthcare workers to support innovative solutions brought forth to streamline operations and improve patient care. In addition, we will initiate the Teachers' Idea Fund to support innovative solutions brought forth by teachers to streamline operations and improve educational outcomes for students. Moving forward on the construction of 20 new schools, as been previously identified in our new schools guarantee, we will continue to advance and lead in the elimination of barriers to interprovincial trade within our country. We will announce initial funding recipients for the Growing Opportunities in Watersheds Trust, and we'll consult with the private sector and develop a plan to eliminate the use of plastic bags in Manitoba. Madam Speaker, our team is ready to continue the hard work of making Manitoba Canada's most improved province. Manitobans should expect nothing less. Manitobans deserve nothing less. Coming together is a beginning. Keeping together is progress. Working together is success. I encourage all members of this House to work together to achieve the betterment of our province for the good of its citizens now and in the future. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Is the House ready for the question? The question before the House is the motion of the Honourable Member for Dawson Trail, that is, the motion for an address in reply to the speech from the throne. Is it the pleasure of the House to adopt the motion? Agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed and so ordered. I declare the motion carried. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Madam Speaker, on House business, could you please canvass the House for leave to consider a session order motion today without notice?
Is there leave to consider a sessional order motion today without notice? Leave? Leave has been granted. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I move, seconded by the member for St. John's, that the following sessional order applies for the first session of the 42nd Legislature, despite any other rule or practice of this House. Sitting schedule for September and October 2019. One. Subject to the following, the House shall sit Monday to Thursday from 1:30 p.m. until 6 p.m., from September 30th, 2019 until October 10th, 2019. A, on Friday, October 4th, 2019, as a separate sitting day, the House shall sit at 10 a.m. until 12:30 p.m. to consider departmental estimates in the Committee of Supply. The Speaker shall not call routine proceedings on this day, only orders of the day. B, on Friday, October 11, 2019, the House shall sit at 10 a.m. until 12:30 p.m. to consider routine proceedings and orders of the day, subject to item 10. C, the House shall not sit on the mornings of Tuesday, October 1, 2019, and Thursday, October 3rd, 2019. D, if there are more than 40 hours of estimates time remaining when the House rises on Friday, October 4th, 2019, the House shall then sit on the mornings of Tuesday, October 8th, 2019, and Thursday, October 10th, 2019, from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. to consider departmental estimates. If there are fewer than 40 hours of estimates time remaining when the House rises on Friday, October 4th, 2019, the House shall not sit on the mornings of Tuesday, October 8th, 2019, and Thursday, October 10th, 2019, from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Budget process, reinstatement of financial process from the fourth session, 41st Legislature. Two, the steps or segments of the financial process introduced and concluded during the fourth session of the 41st Legislature shall be reinstated in this first session of the 42nd Legislature as follows. A, the introduction, debate, and adoption of the budget motion and messages of Her Honor the Lieutenant Governor tabled on March 7, 2019 shall be deemed to have been introduced, considered, and concluded during the first session of the 42nd Legislature, and that the ensuing steps of the financial process be continued in this current session. B, the sequence for consideration of the departmental estimates by the Committee of Supply tabled in this House on March 21st, 2019 shall be reinstated and remain in effect for the duration of this session, subject to any subsequent amendment agreed to by the House leaders of the recognized parties. C, the departmental estimates shall be reinstated during the first session of the 42nd Legislature at the same stage they were when the fourth session of the 41st Legislature was dissolved, with 92 hours and 26 minutes left for consideration of the same. D, the consideration of departmental estimates must be concluded by Thursday, October 10th, and reported to the House by Friday, October 11th, 2019. On Thursday, October 10th, subject to item 15, if all departmental estimates resolutions have not passed, the chairpersons of the Committee of Supply shall immediately put all questions necessary to dispose of the remaining matters. These questions are not subject to debate, amendment, or adjournment. E, the consideration of all remaining steps in the main and capital supply procedures set out in Appendix D of the rules, orders, and forms of proceedings of the Legislative Assembly of Manitoba, bracket the rules, close bracket, must be concluded by Friday, October 11, 2019. Reinstatement of Bill Number 22. Reinstatement of Bill Number 22, the Business Registration, Supervision, and Ownership Transparency Act, various acts amended from the fourth session of the 41st Legislature. 3, Bill Number 22, the Business Registration, Supervision, and Ownership Transparency Act, various acts amended, is to be reinstated during the first session of the 42nd Legislature at the same second reading stage it was at when the fourth session of the 41st Legislature was dissolved. Conclusion of the second reading committee stage, report stage amendment, and concurrence in third reading on Bill Number 22. 4, second reading stage on Bill Number 22 is to be completed on or before Wednesday, October 2nd, 2019. If necessary, 30 minutes prior to the adjournment hour on Wednesday, October 2nd, 2019, the Speaker must interrupt the proceedings and, without seeing the clock, put all questions necessary to conclude without further debate or amendment the second reading stage of Bill Number 22. 5, Rule 92, Bracket 7 of the rules regarding the requirement for 2 days' notice of a standing committee meeting is to be waived for Bill Number 22. 6, committee stage on Bill Number 22 is to be completed no later than Monday, October 7th, 2019, and reported to the House on Tuesday, October 8th, 2019. 7, if the committee stage is not completed by the noted date, the following provisions are to apply if a committee is sitting. A, the committee shall not rise until clause by clause is completed and the question to report the bill has been decided by the committee. B, if the committee has not completed public presentations, it must close public presentations at 9 p.m. By unanimous consent, the deadline can be extended to 10 p.m. The public has the ability to provide written submissions for an additional 24 hours. C, at 11 p.m., any member of the committee who wishes to move an amendment to Bill Number 22 must file 20 copies of the amendment with the clerk of the committee, and the clerk must distribute the amendment to members of the committee. After that time, an amendment may be moved only if copies of it were filed with the clerk and distributed as required by this provision. D, at midnight, the chair of the committee must interrupt the